Teresa Scott from Kennedy Scott. I was very, very interested in sickness review. Do you know what sort of a breakdown of those people that are on long-term sick are quoted as suffering from stress or depression?
The figures for sickness absence seems to mirror the ones that, that the ESA ones pretty closely. So it seems to be roughly 40% with mental health issues, roughly 25% with musculoskeletal. I mean, you know these figures. And then other things being, a mix. The people, I mean, Carol has got a lovely line on this. She says it with a slight sneer, and that's not the wrong word, not quite sneer. She says people with symptoms. What she means by that is, you get to 4 to 6 weeks and you've got some symptoms, but nothing that a doctor would say, right, let's get you into traction for 6 weeks in hospital because you've broken your back or whatever it is. People that actually the medical system, sees you've got some symptoms but actually doesn't do anything with. Those are the people that, when you go through these fit for work pilots, you find have not got a true medical condition. They've got other things happening, but not a medical condition. But the ratios are similar. I mean, the really interesting thing about this, and again, these figures, because people haven't looked at this system closely at all, and that's what this review will find out. It's very interesting to look at the difference between big companies with occupational health schemes and small companies. Occupational health schemes, I mean, I'm plucking numbers slightly from memory, so forgive me if I'm wrong. I think big companies paying occupational health, 80% of them, paying occupational sick pay, 80% of those will actually have occupational health facilities to support people. The figure for smaller companies, where they're paying statutory sick pay, they're probably hiring less expensive people, so there's not much incentive for them. I think the figure is down below 20% have got access to occupational health, private occupational health. The other thing that is really interesting about this country and different, and dramatically different, say, from the Dutch experience, is how few occupational health professionals we have. And actually, are they doing the right thing anyway in terms of mental, the big problem is mental health. How many of those people are experts in mental health? So occupational health, order of, and these are not exact statistics, so I'm going to be very interested to find what Carol and David find out. Occupational health, we have four professionals, I think, per 1,000 in this country. I think it's 34 in Holland. I forget the exact, what units are, but that's the order of difference. Now, there's going to be differences in the shape of support and the role of the NHS and all that, but there is something very interestingly wrong that we are not supporting workers, who have a problem, get back to work. So one of the things that review is going to look at very closely is what are the support mechanisms and how long would it take to build an industry to do all that? So, I mean, this is a massively interesting area. Long answer.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for raising the point about sort of joined up government. And I thought, it's one example where it shows that you can't always compare country by country, because in the Netherlands, health and welfare are part of the same ministry. Employers have insurance-based systems. So they can sort of link, I believe, the employer health benefits with some aspects of the welfare system in a way that we can't here, because our NHS is quite separate from the way we deal with welfare. So,
well, the Dutch system is interesting, and clearly is one of the ones to look at very closely, because they have an insurance-based system, and it's a long system. I think the exposure is, the corporates insure out to the 3-year point. But it hasn't worked as well as one would hope, and one of the reasons may be that they disempowered by insuring it in that ruthless way, they well, may have disempowered the line manager, who is the key person in terms of getting the first back. So we've got to take the lesson, but we've got to.
I'm going to talk about it a little bit later. About
okay.
I think you can. I think there's a lesson to be learned, but you have to be very careful what you, because there is a downside too on the system. But I will come in my presentation. I will.
You're going to learn all about that.
Oh. Yeah.
You're going to learn about. But I mean, you know, I think our review, you know, will probably be, you know, a fascinating international document of looking at the lessons of this around the world.
I think Gavin had a question on the joined-up government before you.
I have, having spent a couple of years working for ministers in my previous life before in the think tank world. But how are you engaging the other government departments, each of which are also running radical reform programs? So health, we don't really need to talk about it, it's significant. Justice, rehabilitation, revolution. DWP running, you know, the biggest change to the welfare state since it was put into place in this country. Each of those departments have got their own secretary of state which are trying to deliver their programs, but actually joining this all up so that you are able to support people back into work across, and for each of those departments recognizing their role in that, because they will see a reduction in their costs if they get it right. What sort of mechanism are you using for that? Because joined up government has got a bit of a checkered history within our government.
Okay, well look, let me just go back a step onto the philosophy here. I've been really puzzled by when I was doing the child poverty bill. I did as much reading as I possibly could, and some of the best reading came out of York University, Roy's here. And Jonathan Bradshaw, his colleague, had done a lot of analysis. And what comes out of it is we spend a lot of money. I think we possibly have been spending more money in this area than any other country, different programs, I think. One of the highest spenders. And we seem to be one of the lowest performers. And the wake-up call of those UNICEF well-being figures for kids, where we came out at 21 out of 25. You know, it's really shocking, especially when we're trying really hard. And Jonathan Bradshaw, you know, just writes, we are just not getting value for money in what we're spending, have not been. Now, we can spend all day arguing about individual figures. Now, that's not the point of this. What really sparked it, why has that happened? Why have we been such poor spenders of money in this country, in this area? Okay, there's all kinds of cultural things, but I think there are some mechanical things. I think one of the things that has happened is that we have possibly the most centralized government, have had the most centralized government, one of them of the Western world. And it is organized by department, your point. They have very structured requirements. The money comes in out of a silo to get that objective, whether it's in health, whether it's in education. I don't know how many of you read Wolf's devastating report on vocational education. I've had my mouth open all the way through. You know, all these spending patterns. But the trouble is, if you've got a troubled family here or a community, you need to join up that money and make it work together. On top of that, we haven't had payment by results. So I think we just have not had a mechanism of getting money to work, because it's come in individual streams rather than holistic. Now, I have been puzzling how to solve this problem, as has a lot of people. And I am just hoping that this framework contract could be an answer. And let me explain why it could be an answer. We can have a provider and a consortia with deep local knowledge so we can localize. We can start using that as a way of combining the funding streams, and we can start looking for payment by results so the money isn't just, you know, blown away. It actually is made accountable. So if we can get payment by results, accountability, join up the money, localize it, and if the framework is a way to do that through this mechanism, we may crack what I think was the big social problem of the last government. Next.
Look forward to seeing
that. Well, I say we are doing deals. We are doing deals, and a lot of local authorities are very interested. This is not theory. This is, we are running around like mad rabbits talking to our colleagues who get this to happen. Take out mad rabbits.
Jill Kirby. Lord Freud, localism and welfare, localism and delivery by the voluntary sector and the independent sector. There are, as you briefly alluded to just now, strong examples of local authorities which are really taking on the idea of delivering a whole service to problem families, working out that that problem family is not just on welfare, not just needing housing benefit, but also problems in terms of crime, drugs, and so on, and looking at that, as you suggested, as a complete problem, and the money can be made to work much better. Hammersmith and Fulham is one of the examples, Westminster, where they're doing this. Clearly, that's a good thing if it can happen. The tension, obviously, in a lot of these government programmes is between the desire to get local authorities to take the initiative and to leave them to spend the money the way they see fit, and obviously the reforming drive from the centre. And to what extent do you feel those could be in conflict, where you've got an authority which has very different objectives to the government, or might actually be challenging what the government is doing, suspicious of its reforming drive?
It's funny, you pick up the first page of the newspaper, whatever paper it needs to be, and it's kind of got a, you know, localism is wonderful story, and you go onto the next page and it's postcode lottery is appalling story. So, I mean, the schizophrenia, I can't use that word anymore, but forgive me. The double-mindedness about this, which we all have, I mean, you know, I know we all feel that, you know, good to have it all local, you know. I think the reality is, you know, we are aiming to localize. Some local areas will do this really well, some will not. Many will be average. But if you do localize and see how different parts of the country do it, you do have a learning methodology and you can start to raise the game of everyone. So that's the route we're going, albeit in a pretty structured framework framework, not in the in our framework contract sense, but in our organization, that we're offering kind of a really centralized set of incentives that everyone can understand, and then you start working on the detail. But I think that the framework contract, if it works, we, you know, local authorities, and many are looking at it, will be able to pile in resource behind the work program and behind the drugs policy, behind the, you know, we're looking at what more can we do for people leaving prison. You know, we're looking at all those areas, and I think local authorities, who the quicker and smarter ones, you know, will take advantage of that.
Sorry, we've got a bit of competition from the roadworks out there, but I think we've just turned the mics up a little bit, so I hope everyone can still hear okay. I think, did you have a question here at the front?
Yes.
And then, chap at the back, after you.
Fran Parry, Inclusion. David, absolutely, it seems to be right to have a two-tier commissioning process, and I'm very pleased to see the framework, but a conundrum I have is when the work programme necessitates extremely high-performing prime providers and supply chains, what do you do about making sure that you bring new entrants into it to refresh it and you get rid of poor-performing providers. The gate surely can't be closed for 4, 6, 7 years, what have you. You know, it's got to be refreshed to meet the needs of the client base as it expands the way we're talking about.
Well, I mean, clearly, I mean, the attraction of the framework contract is that once you're on the framework, you're available to work. We have got some performance requirements, and if there are some poor performers, they can be fired. And then, because the framework is good for 4 years, you know, if we've put, you know, 8 people on the framework and two are actually doing the, you know, got won the contract initially, one was no good, we have an option to very rapidly go to someone else who was on the framework, or we could reopen. But you know, we are determined to drive up performance, you know, one of the again, slightly standing back into the philosophy here, the point about the work program is it's a marketplace, but it's a marketplace designed to do something that we all want it to do, and it's very important for DWP to get as much market intelligence and understanding of what's happening as it possibly can. And one of the things Chris Grayling and I are aiming to do is to have really regular reviews, I think we're talking about quarterly, with the team monitoring you know, what's happening, to really understand what's working, what isn't working, who's doing what, understand these processes. Because if you have got a marketplace, you control it by understanding it. And we're going to try and use as few mechanisms as possible. As you know, the last government, in my view, relied too much on, you know, you will do this, you will do that, with, you know, that kind of instructions. We will try and make sure the market's working, and we may we'll be adjusting rates if we have to, to try and make that happen. So we want to stay invisible, in the invisible hand, but we really want to understand what's happening. So yes, we have got the opportunity to replace people.
I think we had 2 sets of questions at the back. There's a chap on that side, and then I just had a hand up over here as well, so maybe we can take those 2, one after the other.
Hi, Matt Oakley from Policy Exchange. Going back to localism, obviously council tax benefits being localised now. I just wondered whether there's any more details yet on how you're going to ensure that localization doesn't undermine the clarity in making work pay that the Universal Credit should deliver.
Well, what we're doing is we're conducting an exercise with local authorities where we're asking them how could we maintain the taper in those incentives and go local. I actually think it's a tough thing to do. I think you do as well, Matt. But the driving force is we must not undermine. You know, we're doing this amazing transformation of incentives. We are not going to let a ha'penth of tar round council tax rebate or benefit, whatever we call it, undermine that. So we're going to see if we can what we can do. We've got this process, and we will have to, find out what we can, what comes out of that. But I can assure you, there is no way that we are going to undermine the universal credit in this way, and that is one of the conditions of the. That is one of the kind of controls of the consultation.
Okay, and there was another question there.
Okay, my name is Robert Johnston. I'm possibly the only person in this room who's actually in receipt of incapacity benefit and have been on it for, okay, maybe not the only one, for more than 20 years. But I'm also a trustee of a group called National Voices and the International Alliance of Patients Organisations and also another UK charity called Assist UK. Obviously, quite rightly, people here are talking about it from the systems viewpoint, but as a user of the system, I'm very interested in how these incentives are actually going to work out. And if I can just explain something that I heard about 15 or 20 years ago from a young person with arthritis from Norway. He has the same condition that I have, but he was probably about 20 years younger than me. And the system in his country was such that even on full incapacity benefit, he could work and earn £5,000, generate £5,000 worth of income. But the really interesting bit was that if his condition improved slightly, and those of us with genuine conditions rather than symptoms, as you called them, if it improved slightly and the right work opportunity came his way, he could elect to go from 100% benefit to 75%, 50%, 25%, or come off benefit. At each level, as the benefit decreased, he could accordingly earn more money. And if his condition then deteriorated again, as it can with fluctuating conditions, he could go back up the scale. He would initiate the process. Obviously, it would be checked with doctors to make sure he wasn't fiddling the system and so on. But this flexibility seemed to me to be totally admirable. And every time in the last 20 years of doing different bits of lobbying, I've had chance to speak to anybody in the government, I've recommended this sort of principle. Did you study the Norwegian system? Have you come across similar things? From a user point of view, how could you sell this new system to me in terms of incentives and what it would allow me to do whilst giving me a safety net, you know, for if my condition deteriorated again?
Well, Robert, I think we are the answer to your prayers, aren't we? I'm sure you lobbied us, but I mean, think about the system that we're introducing. You have got your benefits. If you want to do some work, you'll just go down, you'll keep 35, at the moment we can only afford a 65% taper, you'll keep 35 beds every pound. You can run up and down that taper to your heart's content. You've got your basic gross award and you can just supplement it. I don't think it's a secret, I'd like to get our taper more generous. And I think a future chancellor will think very hard about doing that, but let's get the architecture. But this is, so you don't even have to do this ghastly thing like the Norwegians would have to do of clearing and, you know, checking and going on to different levels. Bang, I've given it you. You can do what you damn like, earn as much as you want. You've got your IB award. Now, there is an issue of when people are assessed as completely incapable of working, and you've just go out and you're doing 40 hours a week. I mean, when you come to your next WCA, people will scratch their heads. But I think in practice we're going to have some fairly, and we're working to refine the WCA the whole time, and Professor Paul Harrington is really working on this. You know, I think we're going to have robust enough definitions of people on ESA, on the support group, that will allow those people kind of move up and down the taper, particularly with variable conditions, without any real concern. At the moment, you know, it's impossible. You know, you can do, you know, the rule. You know the rules. I mean, you know, we could spend the next 10 minutes reciting them. It won't help anyone. But I think we release you. I think this is really, really good news for people, you know, who are disabled. I think it's really good news, unequivocal. I think it's the Norwegian system. But mechanised.
I think there was a chap at the back there, and then Mary.
Hi, Tom Harding from Westminster City Council. I was just wondering what the rationale was behind creating a marketplace for the long-term unemployed through the work programme, which will maybe target a relatively small proportion of those job seekers, and having a kind of state-sponsored program for short-term claimants via the Job Centre Plus network. What was the kind of thinking behind the kind of architecture of that, of having a kind of marketplace for the long-term unemployed, but the Job Centre Plus essentially being a program that's state-sponsored by the Department for Work and Pensions?
Well, I'll tell you the truth, Tom, which is not often what you hear. I wrote my report. I was asked to write my report in the end of 2006, and the first thing that the Permanent Secretary told me, Lee Lewis, told me, It says, if you bugger up Job Centre Plus, you are dead meat. I mean, I translate.
Well,
so I thought to myself, well, you know, I don't like to be dead, and perhaps I don't want something which will have the hostility of the whole department against me. I was an outsider. But actually, I tell this as a slight joke, because I began to think about it then. You know, what is the role, state versus outsiders? And I tested it with some businessmen, because I began to see, you know, there's a huge volume business in Job Centre Plus, where people basically flow through. You've got 12 minutes or 20 minutes, get them in, get them out, you know, cost you 25 quid, you know, move down the desks, you know, first desk, get your benefit, next desk, right next door, there's your job advisor, you know, go with it. It's cheap, it's cheap, efficient, it's volume, and there's a huge amount of dead weight involved. I mean, a huge amount of dead weight, because as you know, 80% of people are out by the time they're 9 months down. So when I thought about it, I thought, actually, it's very hard to run a model which is both a volume model and an individualized model. It just is very hard to do that. And I tested that out with quite a few companies. What would they want to do? How would they run this mixed model? And they all came back to me, I think all of them came back to me and said, actually, we'd like to concentrate on one or the other. So I think although the thinking started with this rather brutal conversation, I think that's why, you know, I think it actually became quite a rational division. And clearly we can move the line up and down. And one of the things that all countries have tried to do is to find a way of getting the people who are going to find it very difficult to find a job, get them to the individualized support early. Now, I'm slightly out of date on this, but I haven't seen anything up to date. The OECD did a report on that, which was published 2005, something like that, where it said nobody had really cracked this. I mean, I think that includes Australia as well, although Australia sometimes claims it's cracked it, but I go by the OECD on this. So no one's really cracked it, but actually there is, instead of trying to do it, let's do everyone, I think there are sections of people, one can say, where the dead weight is actually so low, we can do them instantly. And the one that we're thinking of most is the people coming out of prisons, where the recidivism rate, especially for young people, there's categories there, is, you know, 80%. Well, the dead weight, 20%, is pretty pathetic. So we can take a risk on that, and we can actually think about putting everyone, or we should think about getting everyone, you know, at the prison gate lifted and taken. And there may be other categories that we can start to lift into the early response. And that's what we're doing. We're trying to find some difficult categories. So rather than having a holistic approach, we must divide everyone, let's go for the easy, obvious ones and gradually work our way up the list to get the early people. So keep a volume process going for where basically, you know what Job Centre Plus is? It's a nagging shop. You know, it's a really efficient nagging. It says, you know, go on, try harder, here's your newspaper, get on the internet. You know, it nags people. That's what a WIFI is. But when you get to harder people, you actually need to do more than nag. And actually, it's very hard, you know, when you've been in that role to kind of look at the other role. So that's the division. I think it makes sense, and that's its rationale.
Very.
Mary Dujarski from The Independent. I've got two questions. One of them, how much do you think the situation in Britain is particularly complicated by the disparity between London and the rest of the country in terms of cost of living? And the second question relates to the taper and making work pay. I know it's very early days, but some of the figures that have been mentioned, I think Ian Duncan Smith spoke about, work should pay by at least £20 a week. Now, I'm not sure that £20 a week is anything like enough of a difference between working and not working. when you take into account the cost of working, like the transport, if there's childcare issues. I'm not sure that, you know, even I, being quite keen to work, would see £20 as payment enough to get out of bed in the morning.
Well, I mean, the figure is, you know, quite simple. If you earn £100, you keep £35. I mean, that's the ratio we can afford at the moment. I think the cost of living issue, clearly, we've to some extent, you know, we've got a separate housing payment in the Universal Credit, which we're working on rationalising, and you'll all be familiar with what we're trying to do there. So the big cost, you know, that London waiting effect, if you like, is going to be taken by the housing element. London does have a problem, probably a worse problem than other parts because of that factor. Although it's got very cheap transport in relative terms, certainly much cheaper than it was, and you know you can actually get to jobs in London. So clearly, if you you can work out at the point at which if you're earning, kind of some of my head, £60, you'll keep that £20. But that's the taper rate. There is an argument to say, what is the level of taper that becomes really, really attractive? As I say, at the moment, we can afford to put in the architecture with a taper of 65%. It will be up to future, or this chancellor in future, to think very hard about the choices you make when you're looking between, do you reduce income tax a penny? When you've got some money to give, do you reduce income tax a penny? Do you play with the taper? Do you raise the tax threshold? And those are all interrelated. So if we didn't have the architecture, we will never have the opportunity to drive some of that incentivization. So the priority right now is getting an architecture which is a kind of coherent and sustainable for the medium, if not the long term, given how slowly these processes change into their fundamentals. I suspect what we're doing now is a very, very long term piece of architecture.
I think we've got time for two more questions. There's a man on the left here who's been waiting for a while, and then you. And if we get time, we'll do that one as well. Perhaps we can do, if we can do these three questions, one after the other, and then we'll have an answer at the end.
Hi, Stephen Duckworth from Serco. I just wanted to take us back to sickness absence. And we have in this country what we affectionately know as a health service. And you suggested that, quite rightly, I think people present to that health service with symptoms that may not necessarily be an illness, but what the net result of the health service is that GPs, and I trained as a doctor, so I'm speaking, criticising colleagues here as an illness service, because doctors convert those symptoms into a diagnosis and through that provide treatments, which may be drug treatments or talking therapies for people with work-related stress issues. Is there any way in which we can introduce a payment by result systems for general practitioner commissioning bodies to ensure that they use employment as a therapeutic intervention rather than pharmacology or talking therapy?
Well,
thank you. Should we just take the other two as well, and then we'll do them all together? So yeah. You next, and then you. Next to him, the guy in the glasses. Where's the mic? Sorry, I thought you had a question there. Okay.
In front.
It's a bit like being in an auction. You kind of you buy the good.
So I was going to pick up your last point, David, about the question about incentives, and that this is Roy Sainsbury from the University of York. I mean, much of the work we've done over many years has convinced us, and I think it's convinced you too, that most people want to work. Mm. We do not face in this country a massive problem of scroungers, etc. Mm. They're a minority, and policy is needed to address that problem. But for most people, work is desirable, and they don't necessarily need financial incentives. So many people actually do go into low-paid work. It tells you that they, you know, most people don't need a huge financial incentive to take on. Whether it's £20 or £35, we don't know. We will see. But what they do need is opportunities. What they do need is jobs. And I think that's what's missing from the whole discussion this morning, really. This sort of the hidden side of all this is and the criticism has been of welfare to work policy, is that it doesn't address the demand side for labour. It addresses the supply side, gets people employable, etc., etc. So I think we're still faced with this massive problem, particularly under the current economic circumstances, of where do we find places for these people? Whether we have a work-first approach or a human capital development approach, we still need employment providers to have those opportunities to present to people, as well as showing them the work pays.
Okay. Right. I'll try and deal
quite
with
different questions there.
Two very large questions. Stephen, on sickness absence. I mean, I think I'm just going to say, you know, Carol and David are going to have a good look at this whole area in its widest possible sense. It is quite clear that we need to get support for people much earlier, and which doesn't seem to be there. Exactly how we get that and how they recommend we get that, and whether, you know, we use payment by results generally, put in the insurance industry, which is one option, and then you know, what are the resources that financial architecture then goes on to use? We'll very interesting. I think the process here, we're right at the beginning, not, you know, to try and understand this, and we need a really thoughtful independent review. I think then we will need a green paper and a white paper. So we need to go right the way back, because we've got to bring it on board with this process. We've got to bring on board, corporate Britain, because they're the ones paying the £8 billion. How do we do it? And then, what is there that the state gains from that? If we cut the inflow from 300,000 to 200,000, the state gains hugely. What would we be prepared to pay? Clearly, I have not done any negotiation with the Treasury. But that's a question that I have. What would the state be prepared to pay if it was done by a payment by results methodology? So maybe we would have to bed in payment by results in terms of the reduction in our inflow, and then that would start to flow back through the support mechanisms that we see. So I think we're going to see, I think this is actually a revolutionary way of looking at this problem. Now, as Roy asked the question, which we get asked a lot, I mean, as a government, I can't dodge the answer. As a department, I can. But because it's not my job to get the economy going. My job is to make it easier for the economy to get going. And some of the things are the inflexibilities that we have put into the economy are very bad. And the worst one that we are doing to make the economy inflexible in our rules is to make mini jobs, short, a few hours here and there, almost impossible for people, or impossible for people to do legally. See it in the black economy. And one of the things that the taper will do will be get rid of the tyranny of the 16 hours and the 30-hour rules. People could go up and down the tape and earn, if they want to earn 10 hours, if they would want to do 6 hours at different times, they can. And that actually is something that companies will welcome. So you're looking at freeing up the ability of the company to do things. Now, one of the things that happens if you have a more flexible labor, you can do more in your economy. It's not a lump of labor fallacy stuff here, that actually if you transform the terms in which you can use labour, you actually open up new opportunities too. So we are doing our bit, but my overall answer to that criticism, which clearly I hear a lot, is to say this: the problem that we've got is the business cycle goes up and down. Let us hope that we have an up cycle at some stage. That is what has happened in the past, and usually that's a pretty good guide. It's always happened, up and down. Our problem has been in the last up, the longest up, 63 consecutive months of up, the longest one we ever had, I think the longest one the world has ever had. We went on with 5 million people locked away in benefits, and we sucked in roughly 2/3 of the new jobs that we created in that up, 4 million jobs I think we created. 2/3 of those seem to have come from people who were born abroad. Now that doesn't necessarily, it's not a complete, you know, immigration suck in because they could have any time. So it's the best figures we've got. What now putting my DWP hat on is we have got to unlock the trap. So when there is an upturn, people, you know, it's people here who take those jobs, and that we just don't suck in outside labor to fill them because our people are unable to do so. So that's the job. But I also think supply side can help the demand side through flexibility. Very good.
Thank you.